today, I'm going to take you on a journey. A journey not of time, but of potential. Potential of our waterways. Now, many of you here, like me, hate traffic, and especially one from the airport. I just got here yesterday from San Francisco, and I wanted to go to the north end, and that's only 5 miles, but it took me 40 minutes. And if you start looking at the map, which I often do, you think, why are we going in such a roundabout way? Why can't I just go point to point right from there to Battery Wharf on a speedboat at 25 miles per hour? And that would take me less than 5 minutes, actually. Now, this traffic problem is not unique to Boston. It's in every coastal cities, New York, San Francisco, Seattle, and you know, in average, in a year, you're losing over 100 hours in commute time in traffic. Although there are all these waterways, there's no fast-going boats zipping around anywhere. Some ferries are there, but no fast-going boats running all over, right? And we get creative. We say that, hey, let's solve traffic. Why don't we dig a tunnel or, you know, maybe build more bridges or get more exotic with flying taxis? Yet, there's this empty stretches of the bay with all the congestion, millions of cars on these tunnels and highways, and waterways are underutilized. Why? Well, that's because small, you know, 5-6 passenger boats, when you compare that to an economy car, really expensive to run. That's like 15 times more expensive. So when you look at a car, you're looking at, well, I get 30 miles per gallon. On a boat, I get 2 miles per gallon. But that's just not all of it. I don't think you want to go to work like that. It's super choppy on the bay, and not to mention on a 30-foot gas boat, it's really loud. You can't even talk. Forget listening to music. And it always smells like the gas fumes. I mean, it's terrible. If you could solve these two problems, right, one of cost and the other of comfort, then what does the world look like? When you look at the map, you realize that 46% of the world lives in coastal cities. If you solve these two problems, then suddenly waterways are no more an obstacle, but another highway. The good news is that we have a solution. Today, with technology, we are able to build something that has completely disrupted the maritime industry. A marine vessel that is not just a little bit better, but a step function better. And what do I mean by that? Is per mile running cost of this vessel is not $5 or $6, but 30 cents. But that's not all. The ride experience is a game changer. It's smooth. As you see in the picture, it glides above the water, no seasickness, and if you were to experience it, which I do often, it's like being in a jet plane, quiet, comfortable, serene. So let me just show it to you because videos are often better than just pictures, right? This is built by Navier. This is a hydrofoiling electric boat. This is the world's longest range electric boat, and you can see it gliding over the waters in the bay, over chops. I mean, it can take up to 3 to 4 feet of chops. And there's no traffic on the water. How did we do it? Well, we started with the physics. Boats are expensive because you're using a lot of energy pushing water. Why push water when you can fly above water? People say it's a boat, it's a plane. It's actually true, it's a boat and it's a plane. So I used to be an aerospace engineer back in the day, and then at MIT I was doing marine robotics. So, you know, I have an affinity for both things. So you look at the airplane, and you know, at a particular speed, it lifts off. You get lift, right? You have wings, and this is a canard configuration airplane. What you see here are wings underwater. And also, just like that airplane, when this boat goes at a certain speed, it gets lift and it lifts off. You can see that wing, you know, it works with the same principle. It's just that the density of water and air is different. So you get a lot of lift even with smaller wings like that. But I have to be honest, I'm not the one who invented a hydrofoil boat or anything like that. I mean, hydrofoils have existed since 1900s. And in the 60s, I mean, you had the big foiling jets, you know, these massive boats. And these were complex and expensive because in the 60s, you're using, I mean, the computers that are needed to run an active, stable hydrofoiling system is, like, expensive. And with traditional outboard or even jet, here they're using water jets, it was just an unreliable system. What has changed? We borrowed the technological advancement that has happened in the land and air. One is cheaper, faster computing and sensing. So to get this boat going, you have to have an onboard computer. And instead of putting millions of dollars in that onboard computing or the control system, which you did in the 60s, now you can put a really great computer and sensing technologies, IMUs and all of those systems, for a couple thousand dollars. And they're super reliable. The second thing is, of course, electrification. Electrification and hydrofoiling almost goes hands in hand. Like, boats are going electric, and the only way to make a long-range electric boat is by hydrofoiling. But it also makes the whole propulsion system so much simpler. And the third is scalable manufacturing. The boat is super light, and it's all carbon fiber. And we are at a point where we are able to build carbon fiber boats at scale and at cost that is feasible for practical applications. So the question is, if we can make such efficient small boats possible, what does the world look like? I love this case study. This is a snapshot of the bay, right? In the Bay Area, you have about 10 terminals, ferry terminals, and about 5 routes, right? At this ferry terminals takes years to build, years to get approval and whatnot, and these ferries are infrequent and only, you know, limited places to access them. This is the disruption. When you make small boats scalable as transportation option, every marina can become a transportation hub. Suddenly, you go from 5 routes to hundreds of routes. The waterfront become accessible. And what does that mean, really? Well, you can have high-speed water taxis on demand day and night. But more than that, you change how coastal cities will be built and operated. Because when you make waterfront accessible, suddenly you're connecting the cities. It's no different than building railways and highways. You're really allowing new infrastructure to develop, more access to affordable housing, more access to talents, and you're boosting the economy of the place where you're bringing that kind of transportation option. And now people here may ask, well, but when we have thousands and thousands and thousands of boats, how do we have so many captains driving them? I mean, we would run into scarcity, right? Well, in the short term, what I'm excited about is that this will open up lots of jobs for operators and captains. Anyone can, you know, get one of these boats and start operation anywhere. But in the long term, with the onboard computing, the autonomous control expands to full autonomy, and any operator, instead of one boat, can operate a fleet of them as a remote captain. And that's how, as we talk about scalable ideas, this is scalable. Thanks for joining me in this little journey of reimagining the waterways. But building transportation is not about just building a cool product or just a technology disruption. It's about building a movement. And I hope, I mean, together, we need lots of people who are really passionate about this to work together to build a future where, you know, our waterways are really life veins of the nation, where we are no longer stuck in traffic on the roads, but we can commute on the waterways in a serene, sustainable way as we watch skyline of our beautiful coastal cities. Thank you very much for having me.